Perhaps no ship in history was awaited with such hope and welcomed with such joy. No other ship had, though carrying no passengers, saved thousands of lives. Perhaps no ship in history was loved so much. And no other ship was so easily forgotten in the depths of the sea. In the port of Tekirdağ, 130 kilometers from Istanbul, a sunny, late summer-like, regular autumn day for the fishermen. But an extraordinary ship appears at the mouth of the harbor. This 12-meter-long vessel, named Bothnia, is the most thoroughly equipped private ship designed for salvage in Turkey. In recent years, Bothnia has located many wrecks in the Marmara, the Aegean, and the Mediterranean seas. Today, she is getting ready for a new exploration mission. The crew carrying their diving equipment to the Bothnia is full of excitement. The investigation, carried on in dusty archives for months, takes to the seas today. Tubes and cameras are carefully carried on to the Bothnia and fixed to prevent any damage during the journey. As the fishermen return to their daily business, the Bothnia sails away. The ship the crew is tracking down is a heroic Turkish steamer lost in the cold waters of the Marmara Sea during World War II. Having taken no part in the war, this ship carries no significance in terms of shipbuilding history either. This ordinary Turkish steamer is regarded as a hero not in Turkey, but in Greece. For it was a symbol of hope and survival that changed the fate of thousands of Greeks. In the years when there was a great hunger, a great disaster, Greece in the 1940s. As the war in Europe was continuing in full swing, this young country, which had become independent in 1829, was experiencing economic hardship. The adventure in Anatolia after the First World War had exhausted the country tremendously. The population exchange with Turkey after the war had also changed all scales within the country. Given all that, it was crucially important for Greece to remain neutral. However, the Nazis were not about to let this strategically important little country in the Aegean and the Mediterranean remain neutral.
Η Ελλάδα έκανε κάθε δυνατή προσπάθεια να μείνει ουδέτερη και έξω από το Δεύτερο Παγκόσμιο Πόλεμο. Στις 28 Οκτωβρίου του 1940 δέχτηκε ένα ιταλικό τελεσίγραφο που ζητούσε την παράδοση, τη διέλευση του ιταλικού στρατού από την Ελλάδα. Η ελληνική κυβέρνηση αρνήθηκε αυτό το τελεσίγραφο και επακολούθησε ένας εξάμηνος πόλεμος με την Ιταλία, Ελλάδας-Ιταλίας, που έγινε κυρίως στα εδάφη της Αλβανίας.
The Greek army resisted the Italians on the Albanian border. Great Britain, which had a defensive alliance with Greece, also supported this resistance. The determination to resist was amazing. Mussolini's attacks were held back, and the Italian army was losing strength every day. This infuriated Hitler. According to his plans with Mussolini, as he was amassing the German armies on the Russian border, Greece was to be invaded by Italy. Thus, Russia, whose supply routes would be cut off, could be attacked in the spring of 1940, and the operation could be over before the coming of the winter. Hitler could stand the failure of the Italians for only 6 months.
Στις 6 Απριλίου του 1940 επενέβησαν οι Γερμανοί. Η ελληνική αντίσταση μαζί με την αντίσταση των Άγγλων που βρέθηκαν εκεί κατέρευσε. Και από τις 26 Απριλίου του 1940 η Ελλάδα βρίσκεται κάτω από την κατοχή του Άξονα. Το μεγαλύτερο τμήμα της χώρας παραδόθηκε στους Ιταλούς.
The well-equipped German armies commenced a general air bombardment of the country as well. The navy in the Aegean was bombarded, and all strategic points were attacked. The greatest attack was directed at the port of Piraeus, which was Greece's opening door to the world.
Εκείνη την εποχή εγώ ήμουνα 6 ως 10 χρονών περίπου. Αυτό που θυμάμαι είναι έναν βομβαρδισμό που έγινε στον Πειραιά τον καιρό που γινόταν και η εισβολή των Γερμανών. Έγινε μια μεγάλη έκρηξη σε κάποιο πλοίο. Μας πήρε η μητέρα μου μαζί με την αδελφή μου και πήγαμε σε ένα καταφύγιο. Αυτό που θυμάμαι ήταν μια βροχερή ημέρα και η λάμψη ήταν σαν αστροφεγγιά να ήταν έξω ο ουρανός.
It took only 20 days for the German forces to completely occupy the country. On the morning of April 27th, 1940, the Athenians woke up to bad news.
Είχαμε ένα ραδιόφωνο τότε. Κάθε πρωί μας μιλούσε και συνέχεια. Και σε κάποια στιγμή μας λέει τελευταία στιγμή που σας μιλάμε, διότι οι Γερμανοί είναι πρώτων θυρών της Αθήνας. Αρχίζαν να μπαίνουν μέσα στην Αθήνα. Ο κόσμος όλος, όπως και εμείς στην οικογένειά μου, είμαστε κλεισμένοι στα σπίτια μας. Δεν βγήκε κανείς στους δρόμους. Έχω την εντύπωση ότι...
The German army's entrance onto the streets of Athens was easier than expected. The sound of German tanks in the empty streets of Athens was a harbinger of the hard days ahead for the Greek people. The resistance went underground.
Από την πρώτη στιγμή ο λαός, ο ελληνικός λαός προσπάθησε να δείξει το μίσος του και την αντιπάθειά του στους Γερμανούς, στους κατακτητές. Και άρχισε να οργανώνεται και με κάθε τρόπο να προσπαθεί να τους κάνει ζημιά. Δηλαδή τα μικρά παιδιά τα ρωτάγανε οι Γερμανοί πώς θα πάω στη Γλυφάδα και τους δίνανε προς το Φάλιρο, ξέρω. Πηγαίνανε, αλλάζανε τις πινακίδες. Βάζανε μεγάλες πέτρες σε στροφές που θα περνούσαν γερμανικά αυτοκίνητα.
Unfortunately, the weak resistance could not prevent the partitioning of the country. The areas close to the border with Turkey and the island of Crete at the entrance of the Aegean fell under German control, while the smaller islands and the rest of the country was left, at least on paper, to the Italians. The administration was left in the hands of a puppet government under the leadership of General Cerrahoglu. The really negative effects of the occupation started with the plundering of the food supplies. In order to feed his armies on the Russian border, Hitler had confiscated the already limited food stocks in Greece, which, because of its chronic shortage of agricultural production on its limited lands, was forced to import food.
Ήταν πάρα πολύ δύσκολο να μεταφερθούν τρόφιμα από την επαρχία στην Αθήνα, εξαιτίας της καταστροφής των σιδηροδρόμων, αλλά και εξαιτίας, θα λέγαμε, της ανόδου των τιμών αυτών των τροφίμων που γίνανε υπερπολίτιμα τον καιρό εκείνο. Ταυτόχρονα, οι μεταφορές από τη θάλασσα είχαν γίνει πολύ δύσκολες, γιατί εξαιτίας του πολέμου πολλά πλοία είχαν βυθιστεί και οι θάλασσες ήταν γεμάτες κινδύνους και νάρκες και όλα αυτά τα πράγματα.
The government set up by the Nazis was not quite willing to quickly resolve the emerging problem. The distribution of the limited foodstuffs was carried through food rations.
Χαρακτηριστικά να πω ότι ενώ υπολογίζονται ότι χρειάζονται, θεωρείται ότι το έσχατο όριο για την επιβίωση του ανθρώπου είναι 900 θερμίδες, υπήρχαν μήνες που το κράτος δεν μπόρεσε να εξασφαλίσει, δηλαδή που ο μηχανισμός της επίσημης αγοράς δεν μπόρεσε να εξασφαλίσει στους Αθηναίους περισσότερες από 300 θερμίδες το μήνα, με τα δελτία και όλα αυτά. Ήταν μια τραγική κατάσταση.
Γιατί να σας φανταστείτε ότι είχε φτεχαμθεί σε σημείο να τρώμε τσουκνίδες, να τρώμε γάτες και σκύλους. και που δεν τα τρώγανε. Έλληνες, δεν ξέρω, άλλα κράτη μπορεί να τα τρώγανε. Εμείς δεν τρώγαμε τέτοια. Γαϊδάρους, άλογα. Βέβαια, τα περισσότερα από αυτά τα τρώγαμε χωρίς να το ξέρουμε, γιατί πηγαίναμε στο.
Τα πάντα. Ξεκίνησα από χόρτα, από σπερδούκλια, τα οποία είναι δηλητηριώδη. Είχαν βουλιάξει καράβια οι Εγγλέζοι με άλευρα και βγάζαν τα τσουβάλια, τα σακιά, από έξω είχε σχηματιστεί μια χώρα και από μέσα υπήρχε το αλεύρι, αλλά ήταν θαλασσοβρεμένο.
Στην Αθήνα και στον Πειραιά το πρόβλημα ήταν παρόμοιο. Δηλαδή τίποτα δεν μπορούσε να φτάσει από την επαρχία στην Αθήνα. Υπήρχε ένα μεγάλο πρόβλημα να μεταφερθούν σιτηρά που είχαν μαζευτεί στη Βιωτία στην Αθήνα εκείνους τους μήνες. Και μια μέρα εδώ στο δρόμο καθώς βλέπουμε ένα καροτσάκι αυτοσχέδιο με ρόδες από ποδήλατα, ένα ξύλο επάνω και ένας άνθρωπος ξαπλωμένος, πεθαμένος, σκεπασμένος με ένα σεντόνι. Τι είναι. Είναι, λέει, ένας πεθαμένος που τον πάνε στην Ανάσταση για να τον θάψουν. Τι γινότανε. Όλες οι οικογένειες είχαμε τότε κουπόνια που παίρναμε ψωμί, παίρναμε διάφορα τρόφιμα, διάφορα, ξέρω εγώ, αστεία πράγματα. Αλλά εν πάση περιπτώσει και αυτά ακόμη ήταν απαραίτητα για να μπορεί κανείς να επιβιώσει. Όταν πέθανε λοιπόν κάποιος από την οικογένεια,
as the world helplessly watched the horror experienced directly by the civilians, all eyes were directed towards the only neutral country that could provide immediate help.
Όλοι καταλαβαίνουν ότι η μεγάλη ελπίδα αυτής της Μεγαλούπολης είναι η βοήθεια από το εξωτερικό. Και αρχίζουν οι σχετικές ενέργειες και φυσικά η πρώτη χώρα στην οποία σκέφτονται να στραφούν για τη βοήθεια αυτή είναι η γειτονική και ουδέτερη εκείνο τον καιρό ακόμη η Τουρκία.
There were shortages in Turkey as well. A large part of the population involved in agricultural production was called to arms at the beginning of the war. Food supplies were stocked for the army in case of a possible involvement in the war, and a mobilization was carried out.
Üretimin azaldığı bir zaman stokların devam ettirilmesi ve olağan üstü boyutlara ulaşmış bir silahlı kuvvetleri doyurmak söz konusu. Çünkü daha önceden sahip olmadığı bir sayıya ulaşıyor silahlı kuvvetler bu seferberlik olayı dolayısıyla. Savaşa girmeyen bir ülke olmasına karşın Türkiye'nin savaşın getirdiği zorluklarla Türk halkını karşı karşıya bırakıyor.
Nevertheless, the Turkish press was diligently informing the public about the great hunger in Greece and was calling the Red Crescent to action.
Bilhassa küçük çocukların halleri pek yürekler acısıdır. Hastaneleri dolduran küçüklere ihtiyaçlarının yarısı kadar süt verilemiyor. 10-15 aylık çocuklar 5-6 kiloyu geçmemekte ve bunların arasında birçok ölüm kurbanları verilmektedir. Vaziyetin bu fecaati karşısında Türkiye Kızılay'ının yeni bir vazife ifa etmesinin çok muvafık olacağını sanıyoruz.
Finally, President İsmet İnönü ratified the decision to help the people whose army he had helped drive back from the homeland. Turkey was to be the first country to lend a helping hand, and the Red Crescent was to act as an intermediary. However, it was not enough that Turkey had decided to help. First, this help had to be worked out within the framework of international law. For internationally, Greece was being represented by two governments. The pre-war government, which was in exile in London, and the Çolakoğlu government supported by the Germans. The consent of both bodies had to be obtained. Talks with both governments were immediately commenced.
Η Αγγλία βοήθησε και δεν βοήθησε σε αυτό. Δηλαδή, δεν ήθελε να δημιουργηθεί προηγούμενο, θα λέγαμε, να ανοίξουν δρόμοι που να σπάνε τον αποκλεισμό. Καταρχήν, μετά όταν έγινε γνωστό το μέγεθος της απειλούμενης τραγωδίας στην Ελλάδα, οι αγγλικές αντιρρήσεις αμβλήθηκαν. Εν πάση περιπτώσει, μέσα σε αυτήν την διαμάχη, προοδευτικά...
The Greek people had started preparations for the upcoming aid. However, collecting and preparing the shipment of the 50,000 tons of foodstuffs pledged to Greece by the Turkish government presented another problem. The campaign was to be carried out by the Red Crescent, but the contents of the shipments had to be approved by a commission made up by representatives from the Ministry of Customs, the Ministry of Commerce, and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. The British Red Cross and Greek organizations in the USA were also to provide material assistance to the campaign. But until that assistance was received, the obstacles for the Turkish people to help had to be cleared. The campaign received national support despite the existing limitations. Those who wished to contribute informed the commission, and upon receiving approval, the aid was packaged in accordance with the regulations of the International Red Cross and prepared for shipment. Due to the large amount of aid collected, the shipment could not be made through land. The Red Crescent had to secure a transport ship for the shipments. The state did not have a commercial ship with suitable capacity. For the shipments, a list of the ships that were sturdy enough to withstand winter conditions in open seas and were owned by private companies was made. Finally, it was decided that the Tavilzade company had a suitable freighter with a 2,400-ton capacity. Curiously enough, this ship, which was built in 1883, bore the name of the war fought against Greece 19 years before. Kurtulus, the liberation. No longer than 76 meters, the Kurtulus was marked with emblems of the Red Crescent on all sides. These were to protect the ship during her journey against possible attacks by airplanes and submarines. At that time, news of the Kurtulus's preparation for journey had reached Greece.
Γιατί ήταν τόσο απίθανο να έρθει από την Τουρκία. Η Ελλάδα ήταν αποκλεισμένη. Η Τουρκία ήταν κράτος ουδέτερο τότε, δεν είχε μπει μέσα στον πόλεμο. Και δεν ήταν εύκολο να έρθει εδώ στην Ελλάδα κανένα άλλο καράβι εκτός από τα γερμανικά και τα αυτά. Δεν το πιστέψαμε ότι θα γίνει αυτό το πράγμα.
Για τους Αθηναίους, πιστέψτε με, ήταν η μεγάλη ελπίδα. Ήταν ο μεγάλος ενθουσιασμός. Βοήθησε και η προπαγάνδα γι' αυτό, δηλαδή ότι λέγανε ότι ωραία. Το καταλαβαίνετε γι' αυτό, για να μην διασαλευτεί η τάξη, λέγανε ότι σήμερα πεινάτε, αλλά αύριο θα έρθει το Κουρτουλούς.
The Turkish Ministry of Foreign Affairs had gone to great lengths to make this possible and had secured the ground for the safe journey of the ship by getting the governments of Germany, Italy, Greece and Britain to give their consent. The route to be followed by the Kurtulus presented another problem. Mines laid on the commercial routes in the Aegean during the invasion were a great danger for navigation. The route to be followed had to be planned carefully.
Kurtuluş vapurunun sefer sırasında takip edeceği rota, yüksek malumları bulunduğu üzere Alman makamlarınca tespit edilmiş ve vapurun mezkür rotayı takiple şimalen 37 derece 38 dakika ve şarken 23 derece 57 dakikadaki rotaya kadar geleceği ve oradan konvoyla Pire Limanı'na varacağı bildirilmiş ve keyfiyet bu şekilde İngiltere ve İtalya sefaretlerinin ıttılağına vaz olunmuştu.
On October 13th, 1941, loaded with 2,000 tons of food, the Kurtulus took to the sea from the port of Karaköy. The ship, which also carried envoys of the Red Crescent, was to follow the commercial route up until the Dardanelles, and upon exiting the straits, was to follow the route given by the Germans. As the Kurtulus navigated the restless Aegean waters, she was being followed by German planes and submarines and warned not to stray from the course. The crew breathed a sigh of relief when the convoy that was to accompany them appeared on the horizon. The crew noticed the horror of the situation as soon as they entered the harbor. As a result of the bombardment, the harbor resembled a cemetery of sunken ships. Only with great difficulty was the Kurtulus able to navigate between the wreckage and dock with difficulty.
Bir çocuk hastanesini gezdim. Yiyecekleri ilk olarak oraya dağıttık. Çocuklar eski ağırlıklarından %25-30 kaybetmişlerdir. Körpe yavrular göz göre göre eriyor. Yiyecekleri götürmeseydik hastanede gördüğümüz yavruların birkaç hafta içinde öleceği şüphe edilemez.
The crew was so distressed by what they saw that they left their own rations for the return journey at the port. The collective desire of all abroad was to return to Turkey as soon as possible and bring back more food.
Babam gördüklerine inanamadığını söylerdi. Müthiş bir açlık olduğunu. O gemi geldiği zaman orada yapılan kuyrukları, oradan birine özel götürdüğü bir paketin nasıl ona teslim ettiğini, müthiş bir açlık içinde olduğunu ve bu geminin gelişinin, gemi hareketini tekrar İstanbul'a dönmeye başladığından itibaren beklendiğini söylerdi.
The news brought back by the Kurtulus added a new dimension to the campaign. Personal contributions were not enough, and there was no continuity in the aid received from abroad. But the news prompted various associations and organizations to action. The Aid Commission was receiving offers to help from all corners of the country.
İstanbul Ticaret ve Sanayi Odası'nın Atina Sanayi ve Ticaret Odası'na 200 koli. Türk Yüksek Mühendisleri Birliği'nin Atina Mühendisler Birliği'ne 5'er kiloluk 100 paket. Ankara Belediyesi'nin Atina Belediyesi'ne göndermek istediği 5'er kiloluk 250 paket. Türk Basın Birliği'nin Yunan gazetecilerine dağıtılmak üzere 3 ton yardım gönderme istekleri kabul edilmiştir.
As the contribution snowballed, on the 27th of October 1941, the Kurtulus set out on its second trip to the port of Piraeus. Today, Piraeus is one of the largest commercial ports in Europe. In addition to giant cruisers taking passengers to various islands, freighters taking goods east set out from this port every day. Koulis Georgiadis is one of the oldest inhabitants of the port of Piraeus. As an owner of a blacksmith shop in the harbor in those days, he remembers the trips of the Kurtulus like yesterday.
Εδώ ήταν το Κουρτουλούς. Εδώ και εδώ άραζε. Και εκεί άραζε. Από εκεί ερχότανε, τότε δεν είχε βαπόρια. Ελεύθερα πήγαινε. Ερχόταν ο κόσμος, το άδερε με τις δέστρες. Και το μάτι του ήταν πάνω στα, να δει τι θα ξεφορτώσει. Τι θα ξεφορτώσει. Κάτι κασόνες μεγάλες, 2 μέτρα, 2,5 μέτρα, κούφιες και είχε μέσα όλο άχυρα. Γιατί είχαν αυγά για να μην σπάνε τα αυγά, φαίνεται. Βάζανε λοιπόν και τα ξεφορτώνανε εδώ. Και ερχόντανε διάφορα κάρα, αυτοκίνητα, πώς τα λένε, φορτηγά να πούμε, και τα πηγαίνανε σε διάφορες αποθήκες κρατικές και από εκεί γινόταν η διανομή στον κόσμο.
The Kurtulus is almost a myth among those who survived those tough times in Athens.
Και δεν ξεχνιέται αυτό το γεγονός. Ήταν σωτηρία ήταν για τον ελληνικό λαό αυτό. Σώθηκε ο λαός της Αθήνας.
Ήταν τα συναισθήματα...
Ναι, ήταν ο λαός, ο ελληνικός, ο λαός, ιδιαίτερα ο λαός της Αθήνας. Αισθάνθηκε ευγνωμοσύνη και προς τον Ερυθρό Σταυρό, το Διεθνή Ερυθρό Σταυρό, και προς την τουρκική κυβέρνηση που βοήθησε. Αν δεν ήθελε η κυβέρνηση, θα έλεγε όχι, δεν θέλω να πάνε τα καράβια μου, φοβάμαι μη μου τα βουλιάξουν και λοιπά. Τα καράβια δεν ήταν το Ερυθρό Σταυρό, ήταν της Τουρκίας. Και δέχτηκε η Τουρκία και ήρθαν εδώ τα καράβια.
Και όταν φτάνανε στον Πειραιά, ήδη το περιμένανε, γιατί αργούσε να έρθει, ήταν και αργό πλοίο, από ό,τι λέγανε. Και έφευγε ο κόσμος από την Αθήνα και πήγαινε στον Πειραιά και το περίμενε.
Το Κουρτουλούς όταν ήρθε για πρώτη φορά έγινε εδώ παζουρλισμός. Όλος ο κόσμος κατέβηκε στον Πειραιά. Νόμιζε ότι θα πάει στον Πειραιά και θα πάει στο βαπόρι και θα του λένε πάρε και εσύ, πάρε και εσύ, πάρε και εσύ και πάρε και εσύ. Αλλά δεν υπήρχε τέτοιο πράγμα. Βέβαια, αυτά όλα έπρεπε να βγουν, να μπουν σε αποθήκες, να κατανεμηθούν και να διαμοιραστούν κατά κάποιο τρόπο ισομερώς σε όλο τον κόσμο. Μπορούσε να γίνει αυτό, ήταν δύσκολο. Γι' αυτό και ακριβώς, παρόλο ότι το Κουρτουλούς είχε φέρει πράγματα και τρόφιμα, λίγοι τα ωφελήθηκαν στην αρχή τουλάχιστον.
Τότε είχε γίνει ιστορία το Κουρτουλούς και Κουρτουλούς και Κουρτουλούς και μας είχε εντυπωστεί το θέμα του Κουρτουλούς.
Άρχισε τα πρώτα του ταξίδια να μεταφέρει μερικές εκατοντάδες χιλιάδες τόνους λίγους, αλλά σημαντικούς τροφίμων, κυρίως οσπρίων, από την Τουρκία στην Ελλάδα. Οι τόνοι αυτοί, όσο και αν ήταν μικροί σαν ποσότητα, είχαν μια πάρα πολύ μεγάλη σημασία για την λιμοκτονούσα Αθήνα, μόνο και μόνο γιατί επέτρεπαν να λειτουργήσουν στοιχειοδός, για παράδειγμα, τα παιδικά συσίτια. Τα παιδικά συσίτια. Η αναμονή του Κουρτουλούς ήταν, θα λέγαμε, ένα είδος αναμονής του Μεσσία για την Αθήνα την εποχή εκείνη. Αυτό έρχεται και σε... Ήταν εποχή που συνέχεια ακουγότανε ότι θα έρθει βοήθεια από την Ουγγαρία, ότι θα έρθει βοήθεια από την Ιταλία, ότι θα έρθει βοήθεια από τη Γιουγκοσλαβία. Τίποτα δεν έφτανε. Για μερικούς μήνες το Κουρτουλούς ήταν το μόνο που ορατά και πραγματικά έφτανε. Και κατά συνέπεια θεοποιήθηκε κατά κάποιο τρόπο στην κατεχόμενη Αθήνα. Σημειωτέωνο το φθινόπωρο του 1941, και αυτό είναι κάτι που θα πρέπει να το αναγνωρίσουμε, είναι κάτι πολύ σημαντικό. Στην ουσία, η μόνη μικρή πραγματική όμως βοήθεια επισιτιστική που ερχόταν στην Αθήνα και στον Πειραιά, ερχόταν με αυτό το δρομολόγιο του Κουρτουλούς.
Yolunu kesmişler. Demiş ki ben sizden bir ricam var, yoğurt bir dahaki sefer getirir misin diye. Tabii demiş, bir dahaki sefer yoğurt götürdükten sonra araştırdı yeri öldü demişler. Yani bu durumdaydı Yunanistan.
Taze ekmek götürmüşler. Orada açmışlar masada yerlerken garson ekmeği kesiyormuş. Babanın gözü oraya kaymış. Bakmış adamcağız kesmiş ekmekleri. Ondan sonra bunlara getirmiş fakat kırıntılarını elinle toplamış, ağzına atmış. Çok etkilenmiş rahmetli baba. Ondan sonra kendi şeyinden payından şeye adama götürmüş, vermiş.
Until February 1942. In four trips, the Kurtulus carried about 7,100 tons of food to the Greek people. But when she set out from Istanbul with 2,000 tons of food on the 18th of February, she was not aware of the danger awaiting ahead. The ship left the port at 7 p.m. and was sailing in a storm considered normal for the Marmara Sea.
The captain had warned the crew that they might have a tough night. With the wind blowing, the snowfall was turning into a blizzard.
Rotasını vermiş, her zamanki gibi. Çanakkale'den çıkmak üzere rota. Fakat üçüncü kaptan Mehmet Ayman'ın vardiyasında oluyor bu. Hemen hemen bir saat kadar durduktan sonra yerini ona bırakmış. Rota sapıyor. Ama pusula aynen gösteriyor. Çanakkale'ye gitmek üzere rota verilmişken Marmara Adası'na doğru bayağı sapıyor.
Serseri bir mayına mı çarpmıştık? Fakat infilak filan yoktu. Güverteye fırladığım zaman elektrikler yanıyordu. Müthiş bir fırtına vardı. Dalgalar bordaya kadar geliyordu.
Vaziyet tehlikeliydi. Kaptan 15 dakika sonra gemiyi terk etme emrini vermişti. Bu emir üzerine sandalları indirdik ve gemiyi terk ettik. Kıyıya çok yakındık ancak kayalıklar çok sarp olduğu için sahile çıkamıyorduk.
Bu sırada marangoz Hasan'ın geminin karaya bindirdiği noktada göründüğünü ve bir halata sarılarak kendini boşluğa bıraktığını ve gemiye bir tekme vurup ayrıldıktan sonra havada sallandığını gördük. Kendini kayaların üstüne attı. Bu suretle kayayla ilk temas temin olunmuştu. Bize bağırdılar.
Tekrar gemiye gelin! Buradan kıyıya çıkmaktan başka çare yok!
Bin zorlukla, bin türlü cambazlıkla gemiye tırmandık. Yukarıdan iplerle kayalığın üstüne teker teker sarktık.
Saat 4.15'te ilk SOS sinyalini vermiştim. Gemiyi terk edip yeniden döndüğümüzde saat 5 sularıydı. Hayırsız ada civarında olmalıydık. Hemen ikinci işareti koordinat belirleyerek geçtim. Bir yanıt almayı bekleyecek durumumuz yoktu.
Yukarıdan gemiciler 5-10 battaniye, bir çuval peksimet attılar. İplerle birbirimize tutunarak gemicilerin gayretiyle yukarı tırmandık. Üzerimiz ıslak olduğu için buz tutmuş bir haldeydik. Fundalıkta 15 dakika kadar ilerledikten sonra bir çam altında kocaman bir ateş yakarak ısındık. Gün ağarınca çıktığımız yerin hayırsız değil Marmara Adası'nda olduğunu fark ettik. Çarkçıbaşı Tahsin uzakta görünen tarlalar tarafına denizden gitmekten başka çare olmadığını düşündü. İkinci kaptan ve iki gemiciyle beraber tekrar deniz kenarına inerek sandala bindiler ve dalgalar arasında çırpınarak tarlaların istikametini tuttular.
Sahili takiben 2-2,5 saat sonra güçlükle Pulatya köyüne vardık. Köylüleri haberdar ettik. Kaza yerini anlatınca hemen hazırlandılar. Onlarla birlikte keçi yollarını izleyerek arkadaşlarımızın bulunduğu yere doğru yeniden yola çıktık.
Saat tam 9'da Rıdvan kaptanla beraber tekrar sahile indik. Kayaların üzerinden Kurtuluş'un tamamıyla yana yattığını ve güverte üzerinde fıçıların yüzdüğünü gördük. İçeriden gelen boğuk gürültülerden bölmelerin teker teker patlayarak su aldığını gördük. Kaptan sevgili bir ölüyle vedalaşır gibi gözleri yaşararak
"Kurtuluş artık batıyor,"
dedi. Aradan birkaç dakika geçmeden Kurtuluş sancak tarafına döndü. Bir an içinde tamamıyla sular içinde kayboldu.
Despite the difficulties, the 34-member crew managed to survive. Exactly 63 years after that event, the Bothnia is now navigating the same waters in search of the Kurtuluş. The records at Lloyd's, which record everything from the day a ship leaves the shipyard, show Hayırsızada to be the place where the ship was sunk. However, what the survivors had told the journalists proves that the steamer is somewhere around the village of Pulatya, which is known today as Saraylar. Authorities keeping track of the shipwrecks in Turkey have absolutely no information about the Kurtuluş. The investigation is headed by Selçuk Kolay. Selçuk Kolay, who has equipped the Bothnia with the latest technology designed for such research, is an internationally recognized shipwreck researcher. He has located important ships lost in the depths of the sea like the Midilli cruiser and the AE-2 submarine. The weather is suitable for diving. The crew gathers to make plans.
Tam lokasyon olarak teknedeki bu ekipmanlarla tam üstüne gelip direkt batık üstüne inebileceğiz. O imkanımız olacak. O çok avantajlı.
Marmara Island appears on the horizon. The first stop is the village of Saraylar. The village is famous for its marble mines, which provided marble to ancient civilizations. The jetty is covered with marble pieces. On the shore, there are statues made by students of the Faculty of Fine Arts. The arrival of the crew suddenly enlivens things up. Once on shore, the crew unloads the equipment to prepare for shooting. Curious bystanders gather around immediately. As preparations continue, Selçuk Kolay talks with the fishermen on the island. Even though they do not know the story of the Kurtuluş, many know the name and the approximate location of the wreck. But the news is bad. It is said that ship scrappers have salvaged the wreck. Selçuk Kolay wants to get the exact location of the ship from the fishermen. The equipment is now ready. Fishermen join the crew to show the location of the wreck. On the way, they try to locate the ship on the map.
Bu limanın feneri. Evet. Burası da yalancı palatya dediğimiz yer.
The only photograph taken when the Kurtuluş was sunk is used to figure out the hill where the ship ran aground.
Öyle bir yer mi?
Öyle bir yer. Yüksek bir dağlık. Çünkü olduğu için gemi pek dışarı çıkmamış. Kafak vurmuş kayalara.
The place the fisherman is talking about confirms what the survivors had told. After a 15-minute trip, they arrive to where the ship is said to have sunk. In the middle of the hill, there are traces indicating where the ship ran aground. Selçuk Kolay and Erdoğan Okuş speculate on the approximate location of the ship, judging from the direction of the crash. But the measurements will provide the final results.
İşte.
Evet.
Down 25 to 40 meters deep, there are some pieces of wreckage. It is still early to say whether the wreckage is that of the Kurtuluş. First, a comparison of the dimensions of the wreckage and that of the Kurtuluş needs to be done. The only way to find out is to use side-scan sonar. Captain Ahmet prepares the sonar transmitter, which was referred to as the fish. Shaped as a rocket, this device transmits sonic waves like a bat to see what lies ahead. The sonic waves reflect from the bottom of the sea and are transferred to a monitor with great precision. As a result, objects on the bottom of the sea are measured three-dimensionally. The first results are reflected on the monitor. The excitement is at its height. Finally, the wreck appears on the screen. Selçuk Kolay and Erdoğan Okuş evaluate the data. Yes, this must be the Kurtuluş. Preparations for diving are immediately underway. Is the location of the wreck and the rocks sufficient to determine the reason why the ship sunk?
Kurtuluş bence tamamen hava şartlarına bağlı bir navigasyon hatası sebebiyle battı. Kurtuluş vapurunun bu seyrinde bence iki tür hata meydana geldi. Birincisi tahmin ettiği yerden daha güneye düşmüştü, ikincisi tahmin ettiği yerden daha gerideydi. Güneye doğru yaklaşık 15-20 derecelik dönüşü yaptıktan sonra direkt Marmara Adası'nın kuzey bölümündeki kayalıkların üzerine düştü. Yani bugünkü Saraylar Köyü civarına.
The crew finishes its preparations. To eliminate any possible danger, a diving plan is worked out. The excitement of the crew reaches a fever pitch. Shortly, the first images of the Kurtuluş will be brought to daylight. At 20 meters, they come across the skeleton of the ship. The sight is horrifying. The explosives used to scrap the ship have torn it apart. It is impossible to figure out from what part of the poor ship are the metal pieces scattered around. They come across a bathtub, the only reminder that once this pile of metal was full of life.
A 2 to 3 meters long piece of the prow rises above the sands like a monument. The remains of the Kurtulus are scattered around an area the size of a football field. The crew splits and tries to analyze the condition of the wreck, which sometimes is 40 meters deep. Parts of the ship that were left as useless by those who blew it apart now serve as home for hundreds of species. Now it is time to return to the surface. The crew leaves the Kurtulus, paying it the respect it deserves, for the first time in 65 years. Its mystery solved, the steamer shall now sleep in peace in the depths of the sea. The crew is quite sad. Nobody wants to believe that the Kurtulus was torn apart with dynamite. Even though the Kurtulus has been plundered, now its location and the reason it sank are known. This ship, which has an important place in the history of civil navigation, shall not be forgotten.
Όπου το Κουρτουλούς για τους παλιότερους που ζήσαν τα γεγονότα δεν είναι μια άγνωστη λέξη. Είναι μια ελπίδα. Είναι κάτι σημαντικό. Είναι κρίμα που δεν υπάρχει το παραμικρό, αν όχι μνημείο, έτσι μια πλάκα που να θυμίζει αυτό το καράβι, αυτή την έλευση, αυτή την τουρκική βοήθεια που στάθηκε σε μια πόλη, την ανεπαρκή έστω. Χιλιάδες πράγματα μπορούμε να πούμε.
Of course, the sinking of the Kurtulus did not mean the end of shipments to Greece. The transportation of aid was suspended for about 6 months until a new ship was found. Turkey remained sensitive to the issue, and aid continued until 1946, carried by the Tunç, the Konya, and the Dumlupınar. However, to the Greek people, all the ships bringing food during the Second World War were known as the Kurtulus.